committing their crimes overseas, but rarely facing punishment at home. On this week's programme, we ask, should the travel industry do more to help stamp out child sex tourism? We head to Morocco on the trail of a generation of beat poets who fell in love with Tangier.
The booking engine where your friends help pay for your travel, and the whistling walrus making waves on YouTube. That's online check-in later in the show.
Welcome to Fast Track. I'm Fiona Foster. Thank you for joining us. Now, the vast majority of us head overseas for positive reasons, to see the sights perhaps, or to experience a new culture. But it's a sad fact that some people travel abroad to commit crimes they'd find it hard to get away with at home. It's estimated that around 2 million children worldwide are involved in child sex tourism, many of them forced into prostitution by poverty, displacement, and sometimes even their own families. Several governments have altered legislation to ensure that their citizens can be tried at home for crimes committed abroad. But with victims often reluctant or unable to come forward, securing prosecutions can be difficult. But now some of the major players in the travel industry are recognising that they too have a role to play in stamping out the child sex industry, as Rajan Datta now reports.
These are some of the faces of the children of Thailand. Young and innocent for now. But life for many children like these is far from easy. 2 hours or so drive from the Thai capital of Bangkok is the resort of Pattaya. The police monitor this tourist hub as best they can. But many kids wander the streets, eking out a living selling souvenirs, doing odd jobs, or even begging. The little money they make can feed their whole family, who are often based in poor rural areas outside the big city. The NGO Ekpat International works solely on the tackling of the commercial exploitation of children like these.
No children should be commercially sexually exploited. It's every child's right to protection. So in that sense, I think for us, as organizations working on child protection, we will continue to raise this issue, because it doesn't matter if there are hundreds of thousands of children or just a single child. Our belief is that no child should be commercially sexually exploited. We're looking at children who are coming from poorest families. They are coming from ethnic minorities, from hill tribes, refugee children, migrant children. Children, in any case, already are falling out of the systems of protection, and they are vulnerable. Street children, children who have been affected by HIV/AIDS, or even children of adult prostitutes, we find are very vulnerable to sexual exploitation.
Thailand is growing as a tourist destination. The tourism ministry estimates that last year nearly 20 million international visitors came to the country. That's up 20% from 2010. But not all those visiting this dream destination are here to see the sights. Some are here for more sinister reasons. The Childwise charity, Australia's leading international child protection group working in Asia and the Pacific too, estimates that 250,000 overseas travellers actually go abroad with the single aim of abusing children. And the world's largest overseas aid charity, World Vision, say the problem of the sexual exploitation of children is spreading across the globe. Sina Van was just 12 years old when she was sexually abused by foreign travellers in Vietnam and Cambodia.
You know, the first time the guy that have sex with me, the foreigner, I know it's he from, but I remember that when I was in Vietnam, I see the foreigner, they say hi, I hi with them very sweet. But when I have been trafficked, come to Cambodia, the first time guy, the big guy, the old guy, look like the grandpa, but he come to have sex with me. And you know, he's not thinking I'm the kid. He drive me many times with me to stay. So I'm so hurt.
Sina was rescued by Somali Mam, another victim of sexual abuse in Cambodia, who now works to help girls like Sina through her foundation.
As a survivor like myself, when I ask the people to help me, it's not easy because they look at me, that is your life, it's not my life. But look at all the kids who are 4 or 5 years old, have been sold in the brothel and got HIV/AIDS and have to die. It's not fair. It's not fair for us. So otherwise we ask you to work together.
Police forces around the world are increasingly coordinating their efforts to stop the kind of abuse suffered by these young children.
Some of the preventative measures are actually that capacity building, building networks so that in a country in Southeast Asia, the police know how to talk to the children's services, they've got good links with the NGOs, and they've also got links to us and other Western law enforcement bodies, all of whom can work as a team and deliver really good effect. Truth of it is, in this country or abroad, predatory paedophiles exploit access to children in a ruthless, manipulative way.
Very recently, in February of this year, in fact, we worked with the Thai police to crack down a website that was advertising the services for paedophile. It was a paedophile network, and they were also advertising the services for child sex tourism in Thailand. It was also a site where they could connect, and then also they could access children through that site. So in that sense, it is a destination country for child sex tourism.
But increasingly sophisticated police techniques can't seem to stop the proliferation of child sex tourism rings. And the problem isn't just restricted to Thailand and other Southeast Asian countries. Russia and other European nations and Africa also come up high on the list of child sex tourism destinations. These are some of the countries where there is a known problem. Despite international efforts, the charity World Vision says the danger from travellers who abuse children is spreading to more and more countries. They say the financial crisis has meant that many abusers based in Europe are staying nearer home and luring victims in places like Romania and the Czech Republic. And here in Brazil, it's estimated that between 250,000 and 500,000 children work in the sex industry. Earlier this year, Brazil's tourism ministry say they asked 2,000 websites to remove sexual content promoting the country as a prime destination for sex tourism. Many had invitations for encounters with minors. Many of the sites were based in the USA.
I'm so tired, darling. These Asians are tough when it comes to business.
I wish you wouldn't push yourself so hard, love.
One of the difficulties for authorities trying to catch perpetrators is that they're not registered as sex offenders. Some abusers have never committed a crime in their home countries, but travel abroad specifically to abuse children.
I'll let you go now, darling. You get to bed.
Okay, sweetheart. I love you.
I love you too.
I'll call you tomorrow.
Bye.
Over 1 million children worldwide have been forced into prostitution. Your money can save them from his.
People who come to a tourist destination, such as Thailand, and then they have sex with children because it's available in that sense. So they are not necessarily seeking out to have sex with children, but because of the circumstances and situation allows it, they have sex with children. And sometimes they may knowingly do that, and sometimes unknowingly, because, you know, there are no checks on ID and so on and so forth.
Catching perpetrators who aren't on the sex offenders register in their home country is a challenge for the authorities. But ECPAT International has enlisted the help of the tourist industry to bring these people to the attention of the police. They've got a code of conduct, which they urge hotels in particular to sign. In total, over 1,000 companies from 42 countries had signed up as of last year. Some give out information leaflets to customers, asking them to not turn a blind eye to the sexual exploitation of children. Others train personnel to look out for telltale signs of abuse. But some feel the travel industry is frightened of dealing with this issue because it doesn't want to tarnish the reputation of travellers or even be seen to be associated with such a reviled activity. Frustratingly for campaigners, progress is being impeded on several fronts in the battle to fight this global issue, apart from the reluctance of some parts of the travel industry to engage with the problems in their own backyard. The internet, low-cost travel, the relaxation of border controls and visa requirements are all factors too. but it's the lack of awareness amongst all travellers that these crimes could be happening just a few yards from their bar, restaurant or hotel that in 2012 is perhaps the most concerning of all.
Rajan Datta reporting, and as ever, we'd love to hear your thoughts on that story. Do you think those travel industry initiatives will help stamp out child sex tourism? Or does more need to be done to identify, track and convict perpetrators once they get home? Do let us know at our usual address, which is on your screens now. Time now for a look at the rest of the travel headlines this week. Here's Mike London.
In India, police say they're looking for a criminal gang who they think destroyed part of a World Heritage site in the hope of unearthing hidden treasures. The 16th century entrance to the ruins at Hampi was knocked down by people with crowbars and hammers. Detectives say they're still trying to figure out if there were any valuables buried beneath the stone pillars. They say it's one of the worst cities to drive in, but now Mexico City could be building its way out of its congestion nightmare. Construction's just begun on an ambitious new raised highway, which it's claimed will save commuters around an hour on their daily travel. According to the Ministry of Road Transport, the city has one of the highest concentrations of cars on the planet. A recent ban on the sale of spirits is being relaxed in the Czech Republic because the government there says it's now discovered the source of a batch of bootleg alcohol which killed 26 people. Local police have also arrested two men for mixing methanol and ethanol into drinks. And there are hotels for people, obviously, and in recent years, dogs. But now there's a place to check in your chicken. Fowlty Towers has just opened its doors in the English county of Kent. Apparently, it follows a recent boom in henkeeping in the southeast of the country.
You feel like you're in charge, but you're not really, because chickens are in charge.
Coming up after the break, Carmen's here with her regular guide to what's new in the world of online travel. And we're on the road to Tangier to discover how a generation of beat poets took the Moroccan town to their hearts and left behind a unique literary heritage.
Hi there and welcome to Online Check-In, your regular guide to what's trending in travel on the web and on the go. I'm Carmen Roberts. Are you sick of lugging around a guidebook that's half the size of your hand luggage? Well, here's a website and app that claims to put a personalised guide in your pocket. Stay.com lets you create your own travel guides for sites, restaurants, bars and hotels in over 120 cities around the world, based on expert suggestions as well as recommendations from your friends. While it might be fiddly reading historical tidbits on your phone, what's great is that this free app stores guides and maps offline, so you won't get slammed for mobile roaming charges while you're away. If you're not so organised and choose to fly by the seat of your pants when you travel, then Hotel Tonight could nab you that essential room at the 11th hour. This handy app works with local hotels to post last-minute room rates for hotels with vacancies. It's relatively new, so the hotels on offer are limited to metropolitan areas in the US, as well as a few key cities in Canada and the UK. Here's hoping they cast their net wider as they grow. Staying with hotels, here's a website that claims to be the world's first booking engine where your friends help pay for your travel. With Backkick.com, it supposedly pays to be popular. Once you log into the site, you can share a 5% discount coupon to all your friends on social media. And when your friends redeem the discount, they'll return the favour and send you another 5% discount coupon, plus kickbacks. The idea is that the more Facebook friends you have, the quicker and greater the chances are you can accumulate discounts. Although for me, the idea of bombarding my mates with so-called deals is a little intrusive. But if it means a hefty saving, then I might well change my mind. And to get to that heavily discounted hotel, you'll no doubt have to take a taxi from the airport. But you don't want to be ripped off in a strange city or get taken on the scenic route through a dodgy neighbourhood. TaxiFareFinder.com will give you a good idea of taxi rates for more than 200 international locations. It provides not only fare estimates, but also route suggestions. The coverage is great for the US and major cities in Europe and Asia, but pretty much non-existent if you are doing business in Africa. If you've seen a website or app worth mentioning, drop me a line. The address is fasttrack@bbc.com. You can also check out our Facebook page. We're on Pinterest too, as well as Twitter. Now here's one for all you nervous flyers out there. British Airways has posted a YouTube preview of their new instructional video based on their one-day Fear of Flying program. The full version of the film will be on the in-flight entertainment system, offering explanations for the most common passenger concerns, including air turbulence, as well as ways to deal with anxiety. Or perhaps the strategy is to put you to sleep so you forget about your flying fears. Here's an app that claims to take some of the hassle out of the airport experience. Bristol Airport has become the first in the world to offer its customers in its bars and lounges the opportunity to order food and drinks via their smartphones. So travellers needn't be stuck in long queues or leave their valuables unattended while they order. This app is very new, so only a few retailers are on board. But if you've used it, drop me a line and let me know how you got on. Tweet of the week time now, and the guys from Gadling have come up trumps again with this video of a 30-ton humpback whale that crept up on some unsuspecting kayakers off the coast of California. I'd have definitely fallen out of my kayak. And even zoos are on YouTube these days, garnering a bit of publicity for their star attractions. Take a look at E.T., the 30-year-old walrus from Point Defiance Zoo and Aquarium in Tacoma, Washington. He's a one-mammal sound effects machine. Enjoy. See you next time.
Thanks, Carmen. We'll see you again next month. Now, the new film about Jack Kerouac, On the Road, takes us back to the angst-ridden, hard-drinking, hard-living world of the Beat Generation poets. One town you might not necessarily connect with that group of era-shaping American writers is Tangier. And yet Kerouac and most of the other Beat poets visited it, leaving it with this curious literary heritage, as Sylvia Smith now reports.
With the coming of Dean Moriarty began the part of my life you could call my life on the road.
The heady world of the Beat Generation, soon to be immortalised by the film adaptation of Jack Kerouac's On the Road.
Where do you find such absolutely wonderful people? I've never seen anyone like them.
The Beat Generation writers travelled extensively, seeking new experiences and cultures to influence their work. One of the group, William Burroughs, was inspired by the writing of Paul Bowles to visit a place off the typical trail, Tangier.
Beginning with the first day and continuing through all the years I have spent in Tangier, I have loved the white city that sits astride its hills, looking out across the Strait of Gibraltar to the mountains of Andalusia.
From 1923 to 1956, Tangier was an international zone, administered by a loose collection of foreign governments. The North African port town was renowned in the West as a lawless haven for spies, criminals, and adventurers.
Tangier has never been a touristic place. I mean, for family holidays, for example. Here, the people used to come and are coming nowadays to find something different. Paul Bowles came in 1931. He wasn't famous for his books yet, but everybody knew he was a writer, American writer living in Tangier. So they all came to visit Bowles. The writer from the Beat Generation came here because he wanted to escape from a system.
Tangier was Bowles' adopted home for over 50 years. Although he refused to be labelled as a beat poet, he became the first port of call for this new generation of disaffected artists who travelled to Tangier hoping to partake in the fabled cosmopolitan freedom.
There aren't already writers. I mean, Kerouac came before his first book was published, so there were nobody. And maybe they were expecting from Paul Bowles some advice and direction to be a writer, to be an artist. For them, it was big fantasy to be here, so how can you explain a fantasy?
Tourists hoping for an insight into this fantasy world can trace the journey of the beats through the streets and cafes. There are also exhibitions devoted to the writers.
Bowles, because he was synonymous with Tangier, was a natural subject for the American Legation in terms of our museum. And so some years ago, Paul Bowles was still living when the original small Bowles room was set up. And then we decided to triple the size because we had lots more material. So yeah, many people come to the American Legation specifically to look at Paul Bowles' works, the memorabilia, even though he died more than a decade ago. There are people who know Tangier thanks to Paul Bowles.
When William Burroughs first came, he couldn't imagine he would write the Naked Lunch. No, it's because, I mean, he used a lot of drugs, as we know. He couldn't work properly, but maybe because everybody used to call him a writer, so he became one.
And it's this literary history that draws people who might otherwise never have heard of the place to come and experience what it might have been like for the bohemian writers of the 50s and 60s.
On the road in Tangier and in the footsteps of the Beat Generation. Well, that's it for this week. Next week, I'll be in Kenya, finding out what the country's doing to reassure holidaymakers that the popular destination of Lamu is safe after last year's tourist abduction. Until then, do stay in touch. You can find out more at our website, bbc.com/fasttrack, where you can click through to see what we're up to on Facebook, Twitter or Pinterest. And you can find even more tips and inspiration on bbc.com/travel. Until the next time though, from me, Fiona Foster, and the rest of the team, wherever you're going next, have a great trip. Bye-bye.